Tonight, a group which for the past few years has spoken in its songs for much of the intelligent, unblinkered youth of this country, the Smiths.
I would go out tonight, but I haven't got a stitch to wear. This man said it's gruesome that someone so handsome should care.
The Smiths. Widely seen as the most important British band of the 80s, this Mancunian four-piece virtually reinvented pop music, breathing new life into a stale music scene and featuring the most charismatic frontman of their generation.
I think the Smiths shine out of the 1980s like a beacon, just at the point where drum machines and synthesizers were killing real music. Thank heaven the Smiths came along.
It didn't sound like Cream, or it didn't sound like the Rolling Stones, it didn't sound like the Beatles, it didn't sound like Buzzcocks.
I just loved the spirit of the noise I was hearing. I mean, the guitar, especially the Johnny Marr guitar, a great guitarist. With me, a melody has always come first, and I just thought they had some great melodies.
This program is a review of the Smiths' legacy, the music they created, and the way they created it. The Smiths formed in Manchester in 1983 after guitarist Johnny Marr famously visited the house of the reclusive Stephen Patrick Morrissey and asked whether he would like to form a songwriting partnership. Both shared a passionate love of music, particularly for the pop culture of the 1960s.
It was an absolutely one of those kind of great mythical moments, I think. A moment that was meant to happen but could easily have not happened. You know, they mostly had so many personalities and so much... so many stories to tell and so many ways of telling those stories that I sometimes feel if he did find himself with a musician who was fairly unimaginative and uninspiring, it wouldn't have given us musical clues as to how kind of vivid and multifaceted what it was he was doing actually was.
While Marr had previously been a member of local group White Dice, Morrissey was expected by many to take on a more literary direction in life, having already published a biography of his celluloid hero, James Dean.
He announced to me he decided he was going to become a pop star. And I looked at this kid and I almost had to stop myself laughing, because although I was in love with his genius and he could see it in his eyes, there was no way on God's earth this strange kid was ever, ever going to be a pop star. I almost laughed in his face, but was very polite and said, "Oh, Stephen, very interesting. Very interesting. Thank you very much."
The union between the pair now complete, Morrissey and Marr decided to call themselves The Smiths, a title they chose due to its deliberately contrary nature.
The name of the band was, I think, partly a reaction to the sort of glossy aspirationalism and glamour of early 80s pop music.
I've grown to hate all bands now that are called The Something, because that seems nostalgic and petty and everybody wants to be the Kinks. So for me, The Smiths was the end of the bands for me. That was the end. The Smiths, it's over now. You know, the bands have finished.
How did you get the name The Smiths?
Morrissey, the singer, thought of the name The Smiths. I wanted to be called The Rolling Stones, but it was much too much of a mouthful, so The Smiths.
Where are we going?
We're all going mad.
I thought we were going to Kew Gardens.
It's a great example of how ultimately Morrissey's ahead of all of us, really, whether he gets it right or wrong. You know, he's got a kind of whole artistic worldview that he's involved in, because he is an artist. And I think, you know, The Smiths was one of his greatest creations, just the name alone, because it was so disconcerting and ultimately so right.
The songwriting duo then went on to acquire a drummer and bassist in the shape of Mike Joyce and Andy Rourke. The Smiths were now a fully formed four-piece.
I saw Andy and Mike as very integral kind of members of the band. All the best bands sound great on record, but they also look great in photos. And when you saw pictures of the Smiths, they looked like a group. They didn't look like, you know, two guys and two guys just in the background. You know, if you look at all the Smiths photos from around that time, although Morrissey obviously, you know, focuses, gets a lot of attention, you know, you do get the impression that there's a real gang. Also, you know, they were good players. So Mike was pretty quick getting his drums down. And Andy is a great bass player. great musician. You know, he is. He's a very good player.
Beginning to establish their reputation over a series of live performances, the next logical step for the Smiths was to get a recording contract. One of the first people they spoke to was Factory Records' Tony Wilson.
The Smiths. When you don't sign a band, everyone has a different version of why you didn't sign a band. There are Morris's and Mars' version, which I can't even remember what theirs is, but it's a bunch of crap, because musicians are always full of crap. The truth about me is that I'd had the demo, I didn't listen to the demo, I'd seen the gig, I'd seen the fact they were a great band. But this was 1982. Factory had started in 1979 not promoting. And when you're the only person in the world not promoting, that's great promotion. And we were the hippest thing on God's earth. Come 1982, we'd gone into a cold period. It's my first ever experience of being cold. I've learnt now, you're cold for 2 years, you just keep on plodding on, and then you're hot again. And Factory was hot and cold and hot and cold, but that was my first cold period, and I personally wasn't willing to sacrifice Stephen on the altar of what I thought was a very poor record label at that time.
I suppose it is easy sitting here now saying, why didn't you sign that band? But there's another 20 bands in town who probably look like they're going to get further than the Smiths. But, you know, saying that, I don't think the Smiths actually did struggle around for a long time. It was only about a year from when they started to when they got the deal. You know, it was very quick for the Smiths. The buzz on them was very fast.
It was this ever-growing buzz which went on to secure the Smiths a deal with independent label Rough Trade.
Factory, Mute, 4AD, then Creation, everybody. It dominated the 80s and was wonderful. But it wouldn't have happened if Morrissey hadn't have signed to Rough Trade. So the British independent scene was preserved by Morrissey signing with Johnny to Rough Trade.
It was in May of 1983 that the Smiths released their debut single, a fresh-sounding and characteristic melody entitled Hand in Glove.
Hand in Glove is not one of the greatest songs in the Smiths' canon, but it's a crucial track in terms of introducing them to the world, because just at the point where a lot of people are saying that synthesizers are making guitars redundant, along they come, re-establishing traditional four-piece guitar rock with Johnny Marr's jingling sound. I mean, I don't think it's particularly well sung by Morrissey. I mean, he drones it, really, rather than sings it. But it does put down the marker, both for the sort of return of guitar rock, indie guitar rock, and also in terms of some of the themes that he then developed in his songwriting.
Musically, it pretty well sets a stall for the rest of the Smiths' career. You know, there's the sounds right from the start, you know, the modded bass, the jangly guitar. Morrissey's kind of falsettos and croons and the very kind of meat and potatoes drumming, keeping out the way, but it's quite punchy as well in the background. So it does link in from punk. You know, it's not like we've gone backwards here. There's still like a punchiness that you could still go out getting a bit of a mosh pit over it, even though it wasn't a heavy metal song or a fast hardcore punk song. And everything depends upon how near you stand to me.
Hand in Glove was an important record in as much as I think it was probably, it served to teach them what it was to put out a record, the excitement of having your own 7-inch, you know, working out the sleeve, trying to get an identity for yourself. I think it's great. I don't think it's a particularly high point of the Smiths' musical career, but it's got a sort of excitement that you can only really get from a first single from a band. It's vivid, it's vibrant, it's sort of got a fade in, which is completely bizarre. I think it's a great tune.
Hand in Glove failed to reach the top 40, yet sold solidly on the independent circuit, helping to further establish the band's already promising reputation. It was their follow-up single in October, however, that was to launch the Smiths' career in truly spectacular fashion.